talking last week or maybe the week before about being real. Are we truly being who God has called us to be? Being real means that we're there. We care. We help. We do. We do well. We share with others. And sometimes that's hard, isn't it? Sometimes when we're hurting inside and we're struggling with things on our own, to go that extra mile and to help someone out is hard. But yet we've been called to do that. We've been called to be there to help. We learned a few weeks ago that we are part of God's family. When we become saved, we are actually adopted into His family, into His kingdom. I shared a little bit with my cousin Mike and Debbie, have been through the adoption system and have adopted children. And it's not an easy task. There's a lot of legal stuff and lawyers and all these things that have to take place, but yet God sent His Son. So when we call on His name like that, we are in His family. We are adopted. We are transformed and placed in right standing with Him. Last week we talked about, the Bible tells us that if the people have no vision, they suffer. Have no goals. I shared with you, for me, a vision or a plan in place truly helps me as we're struggling to get from point A to point B. A couple years ago, I had a piece of tile in my side yard plugged up, and I dug it up and replaced my tile, and it's old clay, nasty dirt, and I knew over time that would sink. Right? Farmers, I stepped out the other day to turn on my garden hose right where I had dug this hole, and I looked next to the foundation of my house, and my dirt's down about that far. So yesterday, I borrowed my son's pickup truck, and I shoveled dirt for about 2 hours. Topped it with real pretty stone. Make it look pretty for mommy. I had to have a plan, though, didn't I? If I would have threw all that extra dirt and rock in there and that ground would have shook and shattered and done what it done, who knows what it would look like. Now, I had to wait a couple years, but it's all settled and it's good and hard, and now we can put the purdies on. You know, I started thinking about our prayer life. Sometimes we go through something really hard. And we're praying, and we think our prayers are like a Big Mac at McDonald's. We get them like that. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's a whole process we have to walk through to get to those plans. This morning I want to share some things. And I know I'm guilty of this, and I'm sure everyone else is too. Sometimes when we leave church and we're driving home, we mention to our spouse or to a child or someone, boy, I wish so-and-so would have heard that. Guilty? I don't want you to think that today. I want you to think about yourself. Think about, how could that apply to me in my life? I want to talk this morning about caring about others, helping with others. And I'm convinced this message is needed for all of us here today. See, I prayed that God would bring those in this morning who need to hear this. And here you are. A youth minister was attending a Special Olympics where handicapped children competed with tremendous dedication and enthusiasm. The first event was a 220-yard dash. Contestants lined up at the starting line and at the signal started running as fast as they could. One boy by the name of Andrew quickly had the lead. He was soon 50 yards ahead of everybody else. As he approached the final turn, he looked back and saw that his best friend had fallen, had hurt himself on the track. Andrew stopped, looked at the finish line, turned and looked back at his friend. The folks were hollering, "Run, Andrew, run! You can win! Run!" But he didn't. He went back to his friend. He helped him up, brushed the cinders off his knees, and hand in hand, they crossed the finish line, dead last. But the people cheered. Because there's more in life, guys, than finishing first. Growing up, I always had to be first. I always had to be the best. But there's more to life than that. There's more to life than thinking about only ourselves. We need to think about others. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 7 through 12 tells us this. Again, I saw something meaningless under the sun. There was a man all alone. He had neither son nor brother. There was no end to his toil, yet his eyes were not content with his health, with his wealth. "For whom am I toiling?" he asked. "And why am I depriving myself of enjoyment? This too is meaningless, a miserable business. Two are better than one, because they have a good return for their work. If one falls down, his friend can help him up. But pity the man who falls and has no one to help him up. Also, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken." No. Let's pray. Father God, this morning, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your word, Lord. And as we look at that this hour, Father God, we pray that the Holy Spirit would challenge our hearts, would open our minds to receive this morning what your word would have us to say. Father God, we pray that your will would be done in this service. We pray that folks would leave this place strengthened to make it through another week. Just be with us now, Father God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Growing up, when I was a little tiger, we had a lot of binder twine laying around. And you know, binder twine is pretty tough. You know why it's tough? Have you ever looked how it's made? You have all these strands, little strands of string wound together. Now, to make it even tougher, Lynn used to take it and put three of them. She would braid it. And we'd have a rope to make a homemade car out of 2x4s and old tires. My pocket knife, I could cut a piece of twine like that. But with three of them wound together, you had to use it as a saw. We are body, soul, and spirit. God's Holy Spirit, when we accept Jesus, dwells here. We still have a mind, we still have a body, don't we? But do we bind them together? Do we draw them together. You see, sometimes in life, we get knocked down. We go through trying times. We deal with things. And it's hard. But sometimes I think it's hard because maybe we're not intertwined. Maybe God's Holy Spirit, we've walked away from a little bit. Peace comes from God. We can make it through if we trust in God. The Apostle Paul, to me, is a great example. He was tender, compassionate. And if you look through all his accounts, you'll find that roughly he had more than 100 people he called a friend. Why so many friends? Because he was a friend. He was there to help when folks needed it. Philippians chapter 2, verses 19 through 30 tells us this. I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. I have no one else like him who takes a genuine interest in your affairs, in your welfare. For everyone looks out for his own interest, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Timothy has proved himself because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. I hope therefore to send him as soon as I see how things go with me. And I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. But I think it is necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. For he longs for all of you and is distressed because you heard he was ill. Indeed, he was ill and almost died, but God had mercy on him, not only on him, but also on me, to spare me sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I am all the more eager to send him, so that you see him again, and you may be glad, and I may have less anxiety. Welcome him in the Lord with great joy, and honor men like him, because he almost died for the work of Christ, risking his life to make up for the help you could not give me. This morning I see several lessons we can learn from that passage of Scripture. First, we need to cultivate a genuine interest in others. Notice I said interest. I didn't say relationship. Okay? There's a difference. Here's what's different. Last night I'm leaving Dollar General about 20 after 8. And I see a car running with his lights on over in a parking spot. And inside are three children, 4, 7, and maybe 11. The car's in park, it's running, the lights are on, the windows are rolled down, and they're playing like it's a jungle gym in there. No mom or dad anywhere around. Had no idea who this person was. Was it someone I passed in the store? Or are they in Dollar General? Or are they over in the farm store? The car's running, guys. Now, when our children was little, Deb left them in the van when it was running. And Kristen decided, she seen mommy do this, she'll do this. And they went across the street and ended up in the ditch. They're in a parking lot that's full of cars. Three little children, nobody around. So what do? I was going to call 911. That's crazy. That's not going to solve nothing, guys. So I went over and introduced myself to these little tigers, and we started playing tag outside of the car till Dad showed up. And I said to him, "Sir, never leave your children alone in the car that's running. Anything could happen." He started to cry. I didn't even think about it, he said. I just needed some peroxide so I could get home. My wife had cut herself. You see, having a genuine interest on somebody's safety doesn't necessarily mean we have to have a relationship. I think in this day and age, we get that mixed up. I don't know them, so I don't care. That's wrong. I'm sure from the time Paul had been to these folks to the time he had left, many had passed and many had been born. He may have not even actually known everybody in that community at this point in time. But he was still concerned about them. He was still going to send folks to them to help them. Missionaries, we call them today, to help them. Paul, I'm sure at this time, was in prison in Rome and didn't know what he was supposed to do. You know, I think of Saturday mornings as kind of check-on family times. Mom and dads call children, and children call moms and dads, and everything is wonderful and good, and we all get happy, and I wake my sister up because she likes to sleep in past 8 o'clock. But we do these things. We catch up. And that's nice. But is that a genuine interest or is that a relationship? I'll tell you a story of Lou Gehrig. He was first baseman for the New York Yankees. And he died June 2nd, 1941 of ALS, later called Lou Gehrig's disease. Back then, the doctors really didn't know how to treat it. So he was in the hospital for a long time, and they experimented with several different drugs, trying to find one, just one that might work. One day, Lou Gehrig called his best friend, Bob Considine, and he said, "Bob, I have great news. Great news. The boys in the lab have come up with a new serum. And they're trying it out on 10 of us. And it's working super good for 9 of the 10. Bob answered, "But is it working for you, Lou?" Lou answered and said, "No, it's not working for me. But it's working for 9 others." And was happy and delighted that although he was struggling with this illness, they had found help for folks who were struggling with the same interest. Lou Gehrig is remembered with fond memories of his battle with that disease and how through him he helped others. Being real is believing in Jesus and walking this walk and helping all we come in contact with. God knew that we couldn't make it without Jesus, so he sent his son. And he walked and talked and dealt with all the stuff you and I deal with every day, guys. Distrust, misuse, dishonesty. Jesus handled it all. And yet he never, ever sinned. and through his speech and his life and what he shared, he was put to death for it. Today, I want to ask you if you've made a commitment to follow Jesus or not. It's your choice. The Bible says they'll either accept or they'll reject. And as I play this video, just think about that a little bit.
Become so hard to see. The world is on their way to you, but they're tripping over me. Always looking around but never looking up. I'm so double-minded. A pink-eyed saint with dirty hands and a heart divided. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. What we're for, only what we're against. When we judge the wounded, what if we put down our signs, crossed over the lines in love like you did? Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. You love every lost cause. You reach for the outcast, for the poor and the lame. Let the reason that you came, what was that love cause? And I was the outcast. But you died for sinners just like me, a grateful lover at your feet. 'Cause you are good, you are good, and your love endures forever. You are good, you are good, and your love endures forever.
Father God, as we close this morning, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for Jesus, such a great example for us, Lord. And we pray this morning, Lord, as we look into our hearts, that we listen this morning. Father God, we surrender to you. And we trust in you, Lord. We pray that this love that Jesus had and shared would be alive in our hearts and would guide us, teach us how to walk and how to talk. Father God, just be with us. Help us stop pointing fingers. Help us get involved. Teach others of your Son's love. Lord, as we leave this place, we pray that we'll be strengthened for this week ahead. And we trust in you for safety as we come and go and have our busy schedules. Just be with us now, Lord. Guide us through this day. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.